What is the best business model to run at scale? What's the best? Now, I've been involved over my probably about 12 years, 13 years, in this industry of online marketing. I've been involved in a lot of business models at scale, and I currently run 4 different business models at scale today. And I can tell you definitively, without a doubt, for sure, there's one that beats the rest by far. And this is not, this is definitely my opinion, but I feel like it is an objective viewpoint as someone who participates in all of these different models. Now, when we first look at a business model at scale, let's define, what does scale mean? Well, for me, I think you reach scale in a business when you've reached at least 6 figures in revenue, probably more like $250,000 a year. That's kind of like scale. And you have ongoing processes. You have things that are happening ongoingly. Like, you've got maybe an employee or two, you're responding to customer support tickets, you've got ongoing marketing process, you kind of got a business that's going at scale. Now, I currently run 3 different models, you could argue 4 different models, all over 7 figures a year. So all at scale. And I have done a bunch of different models. Now let's talk about business models at scale and which one is the best. And we're going to get into this in the Q&As. A lot of people are asking me, what's the best business model? I can tell you, when you look at a business at scale, there are 3 parts of the business. The first part is product. It's supply chain. It's how do you manage this business ongoingly and deliver the product to the customers. All right, let's look at e-commerce. You might be wondering, what is all this stuff on my desk? Let's look at e-commerce. So in e-commerce, I literally sell tubs with goo in them. Really good, high quality goo, but it's like a tub of goo, right? It's like, you come up with your custom formulation, you get your tub, you fill it with goo, you stick a label on it, right? Here's a label, these are the labels for my products, right? You stick these labels on it and you put a lid on the thing here. Bam, you put your lid on it, you ship it out in a little bag with a little piece of what's called a ride-along mailer, right? A package insert. So at scale, and that's just my face you're looking at there, at scale, it's more tubs, more lids, right? More tubs, more lids, more goop to go in the tub, right? Fill it with more goo. To give you an example of one of my products that is full here, some of my products come in organza bags, maybe a little bit of shrink wrap. Product's got a little shrink wrap on it. Pull it open, look. This is the goop that's in the tub, right? This is actually a stick component, but it's just, it's still goo. I mean, it's just a little bit harder goo. It's really good stuff, good for your lips. But the product is incredible. But the reason why I'm like making the joke of a tub of goo is because honestly, at scale, the formula for this never changes. This is the same formula here, no matter how many you sell. This is the same component, no matter how many you sell. This is the same label, no matter how many you sell. This is the same ride-along mailer, no matter how many you sell. Now, as an opposition to that, as far as products at scale, this is a physical product, e-commerce business, direct to consumer, where I am shipping these products to the consumer. I sell 15,000 to 30,000 of these a month. At scale, supply chain, yeah, you got to get the components and stuff, but supply chain is easy compared to software as a service, for example. Now, let me show you my computer screen to show you a software as a service business. This is a business called Zipify Apps, right? And I sell software as a service applications for Shopify stores. So these apps here plug into your Shopify store. So this is a software as a service business that sells apps for Shopify stores. You plug these into your Shopify store. It makes you get more from your store. Like, you can build landing pages, do upsells and stuff. Now let's talk about the product at scale. So this product at scale, it's actually a code base. It's actually just, I mean, if you were to print it out, it would look like this. Paper. It's just a bunch of code, right? It's just constantly expanding. The product is not the same thing. I'm not just mixing more goo. I'm actually adding to the code base. I'm a code dealer, man. I'm dealing code. I'm adding thousands of lines of code to these products every week, which means to scale that product, I need front-end engineers, back-end engineers, QAs, project managers, right? So I need more people as the product scales, right? And I'm constantly fixing bugs, adding in integrations. The product is changing all the time. It's so difficult at scale. The product is this business here, Zipify Apps, which is an app business for Shopify stores here. This is Zipify Pages, one of our products. Absolutely, without question, far and away the hardest business model I have ever been involved in by far. The product is so difficult. It's for sure the hardest thing to fulfill on that I've ever done. I've done a lot of stuff. Now, let's talk about another business. Now, that business does between $1.5 and $2 million a year annual recurring revenue. So it is at scale. I have 35 developers on staff just for the product, as opposed to, like, you know, 15 people in my factory who make this stuff, right? So at scale, for a business the tenth of the size, the product takes more people to create and is harder to create. Now, let's look at Smart Marketer. Smart Marketer, this is the business that you're engaging with right now. It's an information publishing business where I create, you know, videos and content, and I also sell, you know, informational courses. So basically, the two products that Smart Marketer has are digitally delivered informational courses. And you can see, for example, here's like my Facebook video ads courses, my members area, and you can go through the courses and consume them. It'll teach you about how to run Facebook ads for your business or how to do different other things in your business. So Smart Marketer sells digitally delivered video information and has a mastermind, which is a group of about 100 seven, eight, and nine figure e-commerce business owners, where it's like more coaching, consulting, events. And so when you look at those two models, and just, we're only on product so far, there are two other sides of the business, we're just on product. So for Smart Marketer, the problem with product is, while it's easier than software as a service, this product goes bad, right? Facebook changes every 6 months to a year. So every 6 months to a year, I have to update every one of these courses, right? Every one of these courses needs to be updated. So the product is constantly going out of fashion, and then you gotta remake it. So it's very hard. It's a great business model. It's one I participate in. It's also an influencer business model, which we will talk about in a moment, why I would do information publishing when it's definitely not the best way to make money. It's for sure not the best way to make money, and it's for sure not the best business to work on if you want a business that is not, doesn't involve you all the time. But we'll talk about that in a second. As far as the product goes, it goes out of fashion quite often, right? So it's hard to keep that up to date. Now let's move to services. I ran a advertising agency and design and development agency in the late 2000s for e-commerce businesses, where I was doing services for other business owners. And I sold millions and millions of dollars worth of services. Now, the problem with services on the product side is, the more services you sell, the more people you need to actually implement on the services, and the more people you need to actually talk to the people that you're selling the services about what happened, right? And so it's also really hard to set containers. If you've ever sold a service, you know that the person that you're selling it to is always gonna push for a little bit more. They want another thing, they want this tweak, they want a little bit more of your time and energy. So setting boundaries around where the product ends is where I struggled in services. I had a real hard time setting boundaries around, like, where the product ended, like, when was I done with what I had committed to sell them. It's ultimately why I moved into software as a service, because it's ongoing subscription revenue rather than just selling a $10,000 development job one-off. Other thing about my services career, one of my big clients was an adult novelty store. Let me tell you, there's stuff out there you didn't even know about. It's a whole story for another time, but I did a lot of advertising for really strange brands, learned a lot. It was cool. So services and consulting is very difficult as well on the product side. All good businesses, all wonderful models. I support all of them. But if the goal is, what is the best business model for a lifestyle business that you can set up and can run ongoingly without your time and energy and attention in the actual business all the time, and can be sold one day as an asset? So far, e-commerce crushes software as a service, information publishing, coaching and consulting, and services. And then, of course, there's affiliate marketing and some other models that I've done as well at scale. But those, you're not building your own business. You're building someone else's business, you know? So there's no point. Drop shipping, kind of no point, because you're not really building your own brand. So product, as far as product goes, physical products win. Now, let's talk about support, because that's another big part, is supporting the business, supporting the people who have purchased from you. It's a huge part of a business. It's pillar number two. With physical products, it's quite simple. I mean, take a look here. This is Boom by Cindy Joseph. This is my $20 million a year e-commerce store, right? And if you look at the FAQ, I mean, this is kind of the support. Like, it's questions about the product and refunds, basically, right? For Be Friendly, this is a $2 million a year Amazon brand that I built with a business partner. Again, you know, only takes one person. One person supports Be Friendly at $2 million a year in revenue. One person does support for that. Now, move over to software. And for Boom, I have like 7 or 8 agents working on support, but it does like $20 million a year. So there's a lot more inquiries coming in, live chat, email, stuff like that. But the support is pretty straightforward. It's easy to do. Now, look at software as a service. You know how I said we're constantly changing the product, we're constantly adding stuff to it? Well, not only do you have to do that to keep it up to date, to keep it improving, but you have to document everything that you did. This is our help section here. You can see every time we do something, we have to create a video about it. We have to document in a standard operating procedure for the people who have, give me a little heads up there. We have to document everything that we've done. And then our support agents need to know everything that happened and what the app does better than the people who are using the app in their business, which means the support has to be super high level. So it's a lot harder to support a software as a service business than it is to support a e-commerce business, just because the technical nature of a business owner using software to go support the business. Let me give you an example of this. For Zipify Apps, I've got all this stuff in front of me. For Zipify Apps, I have 7, is it right, Anthony? 7 agents, 7 support agents. That is basically the same amount as Boom. It's a tenth of the size, and it has this. So basically, it takes 10 times the energy on support as an e-commerce business does. Now, services and consulting, a smart marketer information publishing is actually pretty easy to support. You do need a high-end support person who knows what they're doing, but information publishing is not super hard to support. Services, consulting, doing things for people, it's hard to support because you got to talk to every person that you're doing services for. So on the support side, far and away, physical products, no question, just crushes every other model. If the goal is build a business that can scale without your direct involvement in every area of the business, that is an asset that someone can buy, that you could sell one day, because true wealth is generated through the liquidation of assets. True wealth does not come from cash flow businesses most of the time. This is a cash flow business. Business I own, I run, it's profitable, and I run it for cash flow. But it is an asset that I could sell one day. Zipify Apps, I don't run it for cash flow. I'm running it at break even, basically. I'm investing everything back into it. But let me tell you about Smart Marketer. So Boom by Cindy Joseph, which is this brand here, and Be Friendly are assets that someone else could buy from me one day and that are worth a multiple of their yearly profit, 5 to 8 times their yearly profit. I could sell it to someone else. Does not require my direct involvement, has a system, has a product line, has infrastructure. Software as a service you could also sell, so it is also an asset that you could liquidate. And again, true wealth generation comes from the sale of assets. Ideally, you have cash flow businesses and assets that you've liquidated to give you large amounts of capital that you can deploy into the marketplace and invest in real estate and buy businesses and stuff. But that's how you get to true wealth creation, if that's the goal, which for most people it is, right? Generate wealth in addition to, not my only goal, it's one of them, and I'll explain that. But Smart Marketer, information publishing, which is this business here. Let's take a look at Smart Marketer. Tell me what you notice when you go to the blog. We're gonna let this blog load up here. But every one of these businesses, every one of these videos, pretty much every one of them. Now I've started to diversify a little bit, but still, Smart Marketer is an influencer brand with me as the influencer. I am Smart Marketer. Smart Marketer does not exist without Ezra Firestone. So it's about me. And by the way, I'm a big fan of influencer businesses, and I'll explain why, but you have to understand that an influencer business is not an asset. An influencer business is not an asset. It's cash flow. Smart Marketer is only as valuable as the next month's revenue from my courses, from my mastermind. Has no asset value. I can't sell it to someone else. And 95% of the information businesses that you see out there are the same way. They're built around one person's persona. They require that person to work in them, and their value is the enjoyment of working on the business and the cash flow it generates. It is not an asset that you could sell to someone else. Now, why would I do an influencer business if it's not the best way to make money? Because it is certainly not the best use of my time if the goal is to make money. Because I love it. It's super fun. I like having an audience. I like talking to you about what's going on in my life. I like telling the stories of I really enjoy it. It's so much fun, which is why I do it. And it's a great business. So I think everyone online today who has a passion for anything should build an influencer business, because an influencer business is, hey, look at what I'm doing and look at how it's working for me. And if you're doing something that's cool in any area, there's other people who want to be doing it who could learn from your experience. So you could have courses, you could have events, you could have masterminds, you could do blog videos. It's just a really fun business model if the goal is to really enjoy your work life, which is my main goal. I am chasing fun and pleasure, not success. I think people who chase success oftentimes miss out on having fun. So I'm trying to have a good time and also have success and have a good time first and foremost. So, let's now move on to the third part of a business. So far, e-commerce is crushing all of these business models by a very, very, very long margin. Third part of a business is advertising, storytelling, sales funnels, marketing. Every one of these models, every one of them, is going to require that you do that well. Creating videos that you can put on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram that are compelling, that engage a particular group of people in a conversation about a specific set of experiences that they're having, comment on those experiences, add value to their life, get them to subscribe to you by consuming your content. Because if someone watches your video, that's a subscription. They've subscribed to you because you can retarget the people who watched, getting them to visit your website, like your fan page, give you their email address, whatever, and then making them offers for things you think they're going to be interested in, your physical products, your information products, your software as a service, whatever. So you have to do that well. And if you're looking at it like no matter what business you choose, services agency, consulting, coaching, events and masterminds, and the reason why I say I'm doing four business models, actually five, Amazon business model is different from Shopify direct response business model. So Boom and BeFriendly are two completely different business models. BeFriendly is Amazon only, Boom is Shopify direct response only. I also do information publishing, which is digitally delivered courses. There's a second business model in there, which is a mastermind group, which is its own business. Blue Ribbon Mastermind is its whole own thing. Two events a year, all kinds of stuff. It's just really a different model. And then obviously software as a service. So if the goal is to build a business that is the most valuable asset for you to sell someday and is the easiest to run ongoingly without your direct involvement, that can scale without you having to be forced in it all the time, e-commerce is a no-brainer. It really is. I can tell you definitively, as someone who has run so many different business models at scale over the years, ebooks, I mean, I've done it all. And I always will participate. It's why 80% of my energy goes into e-commerce, because it's a lot of fun. It's really fun to tell stories and do marketing and build sales funnels and do videos about physical products. It's just widely applicable. It's the most valuable asset. It can scale the easiest because you can put in copywriters and advertisers and tech people and project managers. And, you know, you can build an infrastructure that supports the growth of the business. If I leave for 2 months, Boom still goes. Boom does fine without me. BeFriendly does fine without me putting attention on it for 2 months. Zipify kind of crumbles. I mean, all Zipify has a really good team now, but I still am like, in it, you know, on a daily basis. Smart Marketer crumbles because I am in it, you know, I'm pushing it forward. And so, but I love doing those. I'm doing those as projects that I love being involved in. You know, I like doing that work. But if the goal is to build a business that can scale and ultimately be and run at a profit and be a cash flow business that you can build systems around and ultimately that you can sell, e-commerce is far and away the best business model, specifically e-commerce, where you're either private labeling a product, you know, creating your own brand, essentially, where you're either manufacturing, creating your own custom product, or private labeling someone else's product and building a brand around that, not drop shipping and not wholesaling and not some of these other models, which we can talk about later because this video is kind of long. But I hope that this has expressed to you my viewpoint that the number one business model to run at scale is e-commerce. Take your hands, hold them up, hold your hands up, put them down. Hands down, best business model out there. My name is Ezra Firestone. This is smartmarketer.com. Hope you've enjoyed this video on why I believe, as someone who currently runs, I would label, now I've moved it to six, you know, because I've realized that actually inside of Smart Marketer, there's two models. BeFriendly and Amazon are really two separate models. Zipify is a whole different model. So anyways, five or six different business models at scale, all doing millions a year. Boom, doing eight figures. I can tell you definitively, as someone who's been in it for over a decade, that e-commerce really is the best model if you're looking for a business model that is like going to support you in having the most pleasurable life. Now, influencer marketing, where you're building a brand around your own persona and selling courses or events and stuff, is so much fun. So I recommend that too. Software as a service is just plain hard. You have to really, really, really love what you're doing if you're going to get into that business model, because it is expensive and boy, is it hard. God dang, it's hard. It is the hardest business I've ever done. And I really enjoy it because I like a challenge. I'm always kind of up for something new, you know, but it's hard. I don't recommend that one as your first one for sure. But definitely influencer marketing is a lot of fun, and e-commerce for sure the best model. And I, if you want to run a services agency or do affiliate marketing or do any of that other stuff, right on. I'm not saying those aren't good. I'm just saying my experience has been that they're more difficult to run ongoingly if the goal is to build a business that supports your life and you having a pleasurable life while you're running your business. So, EzraFirestoneSmartMarketer.com. Thanks for watching. Peace out.